Hello there, student affairs fans. Hello there, student affairs fans. It's Tuesday, March 5th, and this is a very special edition of Student Affairs Live, the online learning community for student affairs educators in higher education. I'm your MC, Matthew Ferguson, the director of New Student Orientation and Family Programs at Rutgers University. And today, we are broadcasting live from the ACPA conference in Montreal, Canada, with the first ever contested issues live debates in student affairs. Montreal attendees, let your colleagues, friends, and family know that they can tune in to our live stream now at watch.higheredlive.com. You can participate in the learning community today by following along live on the Twitter, on Twitter, and tweeting using the Higher Ed Live hashtag. At this time, I would like, and it is my pleasure, to introduce the hosts of Higher Ed Live and your moderators for today's debate. First up, she's originally from Parker, Colorado, is currently a student affairs administrator and doctoral student at Michigan State University, earned her master's in student affairs from Colorado State, once survived and won a run-in with a javelina in Arizona, and enjoys running, camping, and being outdoors with her family. Please welcome Heather Shea Gasser. And next up, he's originally from Paramus, New Jersey, currently serves as the senior director for student engagement at Rutgers University, holds a degree in business from Rutgers, and enjoys snowboarding, salsa dancing, and a nice tall glass of sarsaparilla in the summertime. Please welcome Tony Duty.
How about a big round of applause for our MC, Matthew Ferguson? So before we get started, we want to take a moment to recognize the sponsors of today's show. You may know Higher Ed Live is sponsored by M. Stoner, a marketing and communication firm that works with higher education institutions on branding, strategy, web design, and more. And we know that engaging and connecting to our students is important to our work in student affairs. If you're interested in using the M. Stoner's model to build effective programs and websites, please check out the link that we're tweeting out now. Heather?
Student Affairs Live is also exclusively sponsored by ACPA, College Student Educators International. The pairing of ACPA with Higher Ed Live calls attention to the power of a unique professional development delivery with the strength of a renowned professional association. On behalf of Tony and myself, and the entire crew from M. Stoner here from Higher Ed Live, we want to extend our great thanks to Dr. Cindy Love and the Governing Board for their support of Student Affairs Live. Thank you.
Thank you, Heather and Tony. Before we get this show underway, we would also like to extend a special note of thanks to Peter Magolda and Marsha Baxter Magolda for granting permission of the use of the contested issues name for this special event. Our hope is that this open exchange of ideas pays tribute to their legacies. Debate. Debate. It can be a scary word, especially if you've watched any television in the United States recently. But it has been a form of civilized discourse around the world for hundreds of years, with some records dating back to ancient Greece. Today, the debate format will allow us to deliver different perspectives in an engaging way, and with the hope of creating even more dialogues on some of these hot issues in our field. Today's guests have prepared with that mindset and a commitment to collegiality in mind. That is, with the exception of Susan and Gretchen, because apparently the loser will be walking the dogs for a month. Our format today is simple. Each guest will deliver a 60-second opening statement. After that, each side will have 60 seconds to answer a question from one of our moderators. I will then pose a crowdsourced question, which will allow for a 45-second answer and a 45-second rebuttal from the other side. And we'll bring it home with a 30-second closing statement from each guest. I will remind our guests that there are time limits in place to keep the show moving. When you hear this bell, please conclude the current thought as quickly as possible. Yes, Patrick Love, the bell applies to you as well. For those of you, at that point, the audience will help us choose a winner. For those of you tuning into watch.higheredlive.com, you will notice that you have a choice to help us choose which of the winners is. We will take that along with our audience. You will notice you have two cards, a red and a blue card. I will instruct you who that card refers to, and you will help us to choose our ultimate winner. The winner of each debate receives ultimate bragging rights until 2017 and drinks on Gavin Henning for a year. All right, Higher Ed Live viewers and ACPA attendees, away we go. Our first topic is credentialing. Should we require credentialing for student affairs professionals? Let's meet our guests for this debate. On one side of the debate, hailing from Stephenville, Texas, he is currently the dean and a faculty member for the College of Education at Texas State University, earned his PhD in counseling and student personnel from the University of Georgia, and enjoys spending time with his five grandchildren and the occasional round of golf in Scotland. Please make some noise for Stan Carpenter. And on the opposing side, hailing from Maplewood, New Jersey, he is currently the Vice President for Student Affairs at the New York Institute of Technology, earned his PhD at Indiana University, and enjoys collecting antique dictionaries when he's not busy scaling Mount Rainier, the tallest volcano in the United States. Yes, he's trying to make you nervous, Stan. Please welcome Patrick Love. Take it away, Tony.
All right, we're going to get right into it. So arguing for credentialing is Stan, and Stan, your 60 seconds starts now.
I speak in favor of credentialing in student affairs. And what that really means, because most people don't know, is it means a public voluntary commitment to excellent professional preparation, ongoing professional development, and consequent, intentional, informed, and ethical practice. Professional preparation, either in traditional terms or in a variety of other ways, that could be and are already somewhat laid out by a process of peer review and provided by professional associations and others. Lots of them low-cost ways and travel efficient so that preparation is open for all. Professional development that is similarly diverse in content, nature, and delivery so that everyone can be served in ways that are peer-reviewed and vetted in some way. An intentional practice that reflects the state of the art in our profession, changing always but built on a firm foundation. It means that someone commits to be bound by the ethics of the student affairs profession overtly and publicly. This is not licensure, it's not even gatekeeping, it's voluntary excellence.
Very good, thank you, Stan. All right, Patrick, you've got 60 seconds to respond, going now.
I'm against credentialing because we already have a credential. It's a master's in college student personnel. It's anti-innovation. It's no way can it keep up with the evolutionary and revolutionary changes in our field. The cost of this process will inevitably be borne by entry-level professionals, those who can least afford it. According to Carl Rogers, credentialing creates monopolistic professions, which are against our professional values. It will further narrow the avenues of access to this field from those from non-traditional backgrounds. A general student affairs professional who's credentialed, it's going to have to be written so broadly as to be meaningless. And finally, there are 45 areas, sections in the CAS standards. Are we going to write credentials to cover all 45? Or are we going to have 45 separate credentials?
All right, they were not prepared for these questions. I will warn you. So Stan, you ready? So Matt mentioned earlier that you are a faculty member, and I see you haven't made a recommendation that we implement credentialing for faculty. So I could have a PhD in art history, for instance, and still not have any competency or skill in teaching or pedagogy. So Why are you making a distinction? Why are you suggesting that practitioners be held to a higher standard?
So the notion that faculty members don't have a credentialing process is specious at best and naive at worst. Of course we do.
It's me, it's not Patrick.
I know.
Right.
But the idea is nonetheless not true. When we're hired for our jobs, they have to do with a degree in X field or Y field, or you know, our research areas in a certain place or not a certain place, and our teaching and our service and our research and scholarship is vetted annually. And after a six-year probation period that no practitioner has to undergo, I don't agree with you that we don't have credentialing. We do have to be good teachers. We do have to be good at our scholarship. We do have to be good at service and make contributions in all those areas. Just as we're asking a practitioner to do, we have to keep up with the field.
Excellent. Fair enough. All right, Patrick. Now, I've known you for some years now, and I know you to be a person who places a high value on assessment. So my question to you is simple. You mentioned caste standards. What is the value of a standard if we don't have accountability, if there isn't a way to verify it?
Tony, I think the answer to that question is, who's doing the verifying? And it's my argument. Stan mentioned that this is voluntary professional development. I believe that the people who are best able to assess the quality of a person's work is the person doing the hiring, the people in charge of the unit and the division. So they're the ones tasked with hiring excellent people, making sure that they're trained, they continue on in their professional development, because if they don't do that, they will not be serving students well, they will not be successful in the work that they're doing, and that will show in their own assessment of their service to students, their ability to influence student outcomes. So I think the responsibility to meeting standards rests with the individual institution, not with the profession.
Outstanding. All right, Matt, to you for the Twitterverse question.
Yes, so we're going to direct this one to Stan Carpenter. The beauty of experiences like ACPA is often the ability to explore areas outside of your job and share innovative practices. If credentialing becomes required, isn't there a danger that conference sessions and curricula will become more rigid and too standardized? 45 seconds begins now.
I don't know how you can say that a profession that's keeping up would become rigid and standardized. In fact, what we would say is that you have to have a professional preparation that we would all agree on. And yes, we have to figure out how to be more flexible than some other professions have been in the past. Of course we do, right? But then you have to keep up. Then every 3 years you have to get X amount of professional development. And all we're talking about here is a way to organize your own professional development in ways that are vetted and suggested by the rest of the profession. Look, the doctors do it, the lawyers do it, the accountants do it, the plumbers do it, the electricians do it, the hairdressers do this.
Patrick, 45-second rebuttal.
Well, when he says everybody does it, everybody doesn't do it. It is typical credentialing is typically done in professions where the public needs to be protected from the potential harm done by professionals. So when we're talking about that level of credentialing, we're talking about nursing, we're talking about medicine, we're talking about law. Putting student affairs in general in those kind of high-risk categories, I don't think is valid.
Very good. All right, so we are at our concluding statements. Stan, you've got 30 seconds to have your closing argument.
Speaking to Patrick's last point, doctors bury their mistakes. Ours walk around for 50 or 60 years. Look, Look, there aren't any monsters under the bed. There's only the next inevitable step in our development as a profession. NERSA is already on the way to doing this. Akuho Eyes made a good start. Even NASPA is offering certificates in specific areas. And ACPA is rolling out my portfolio at this conference to help organize people's professional development. The tools are almost here. The future is now for credentialing.
Thank you very much. All right, 30 seconds.
My problem is with conflating credentialing with professional development. I am absolutely committed to high-quality professional development. What I am not committed to is having other people tell me what my staff needs to know today and tomorrow and the next day. Again, I repeat my initial point. It's anti-innovation. It's not going to be able to keep up with me and my staff and the needs that our students are expressing.
Okay, now it's time for our audience to decide. If you are Team Stan Carpenter, raise your red card. If you are Team Patrick Love, raise your blue card. We're also going to take into account our internet poll.
Wow, that's close.
Close, but we're going to award it to, at least initial results, have our winner as Patrick Love. Yeah. How about a nice big round of applause for both Patrick Love and
Stan Carpenter.
Thank you
very much. Outstanding. Woo! Good job, guys. Thank you very much. Great way to start us.
All right, our next topic is move up or move out. Is it better to move up at the same institution or branch out to other institutions? Let's meet our guests for this debate. On the move outside of the debate, originally from Winchester, Virginia, he is currently the Vice President for Student Affairs at Indiana University, Purdue University, Indianapolis. Earned his doctorate at Nova Southeastern University, was once ranked top 10 for his weight class in martial arts fighting and open hand kata, and unwinds by playing jazz and blues standards on the trombone. Here he is, Zeb Davenport. And on the move upside of this debate, hailing from Bloomington, Indiana, she is currently a faculty member and Student Affairs Master's Program Coordinator at Indiana University, earned her PhD in higher ed from Indiana University, and enjoys cruises, all things Disney, and playing the violin. Here she is, Danielle DeSawell. Heather, take it away.
All right, we have opening statements first. In the proposition, this is Zeb. Your 60 seconds begins now.
Madam Moderator, I don't need 60 seconds to do this. Let me be absolutely clear. My position is that professionals often have to move out before they move up. And first I'll start with just the practicality of staying in one place too long. You only usually have one vice president for student affairs, one dean of students, one or two AVPs maybe, one director of your dream job, and a smattering of assistant and associate directors. So practically speaking, it's not enough room for everybody to stay at their place and get the dream job they want. Second, I often hear people talking about being comfortable. I know the job like the back of my hand. I can do the job with my eyes closed. I know the people, the places, and the politics. That suggests to me that we've reached this level of capacity and we begin to move into the realm of complacency. And that takes us into the place of stagnation. And we know that stagnant waters do two things. They get murky and they stink. Hence, we often have to move out before we move up.
All right. Danielle, your 60 seconds begins now.
All right, well, let's just be clear about what we're actually arguing about is not incompetent professionals, but rather competent professionals who are looking to either move up at their institution or to move out and go to another institution to learn a new culture and figure out then how to make an impact in a different place. Whereas they could use their understanding and knowledge of the campus culture, the subcultures, their relationships that they've built, and what they've observed that needs to be changed to actually enact that change at the institution in which they're staying. So one of the things you want to think about is when you stay at the same institution and you seek those opportunities, you can design for yourself yourself a career path that you can use the professional competencies to advance yourself within those realms in order to not only create and advance your own professional career, but also to see and find ways to create better conditions for learning, for the students, and for professional growth within that institution.
La, 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 la.
All right. All right, Zeb, my question for you is, don't you think that so much of our effectiveness and our ability to get things done depends upon those long-term connections and understanding of the networks and the culture of the institution? Don't we lose a lot of ground when new people come in and they have to learn both the operation and the culture?
So I have to state John Maxwell, who says, people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. And they learn and know how much you care by building relationships. I once read that trust, a change happens at the rate that you can build trust. So it doesn't matter how long you've been at a place. It matters what you do to cultivate the relationship, the trust, and the respect. And then you can make change. And you don't go to a place to make change. You see what's happening there. And if change needs to be made, then you work with the people who are in that culture after you've learned it, okay? Then you begin to make the change. See, there's two types of knowledge. There's institutional knowledge and there's content knowledge. You have to respect both, because if you come in knowing all things and you don't respect the institutional knowledge, you'll never make change. It's not about having to stay at a place forever to make change. It's about building trust and respect for the constituents with whom you serve, which will allow you to make the change.
All right, thank you. Danielle, my question for you is, Zeb talked about stagnation, okay? Stagnation and complacency. So we all understand and the value of bringing in diverse perspectives, new ideas. So how do you do that? How do you instill innovation in an organization without a regular turnover of the staff?
Excellent question. So one of the things you want to think about is that if you are unable to see where improvement needs to be made, then absolutely I would move out and go work for Zeb. But when you see where change needs to be made, then you have the opportunity to bring people into that environment, both from inside and outside of the organization, in order to enhance that operation. So you're looking at the skills and the competencies that are needed in order to advance what it is you're trying to do with learning outcomes, student conditions, programs and services, and then what you do is you are attentive to understanding that culture, so you're able then to say, these are the people I need and these are the competencies and the skills those people maintain that I need to bring into my organization.
All right.
I didn't even need all 60.
You didn't.
I'll give you a...
Thanks.
All right, from the Twitterverse and the audience, here is our question. We are actually going to direct it to Danielle. While the argument for moving up is often to preserve institutional knowledge, isn't a potential pitfall in that ideology that silos and groupthink become solidified on campus? 45 seconds.
Absolutely. And once again, one of the things you want to think about is that if you find yourself being that person who is siloing those institutions, then you want to go find where Dr. Zeb Davenport is and go work for him at that. But what the relationships that you've built, those are the pieces that you want to utilize in order to continue to advance forward movement in that organization. So you want to think about, how do I continually break down those silos in those environments so that you avoid the stagnation and keep the innovation moving forward within your organization.
45 second rebuttal.
First, I'd just like to start by saying she said absolutely. When you talk about staying at a place, you can have silos and become stagnant. And she started her debate, her rebuttal with absolutely. I don't really have to say any more, but I will.
Of course.
The thing about it is that groupthink can happen unintentionally. And folks who often stay at the same place for too long begin to have groupthink and they don't even understand, don't even realize it. So it can create situations and stumbling blocks that we're not even aware of. So my point again is sometimes we just have to move out after we've gained that knowledge to move up.
All right, now we are ready for our closing statements. So we are going to begin with Danielle. 30 seconds, go.
All right, so the benefits of a single institutional experience are understanding your campus culture, understanding the relationships and the politics that are part of that. And while it can be viewed as a hindrance in some ways, the way in which to be successful with that is to approach your work from a lens of using your knowledge to advance and improve that organization so that you will find success at every single institution that you're at.
Very nice, thank you. All right, closing statement.
Very, very nice. Very nice. All right, so I will say this, that you should never take a job with the next job in mind. When you get to a place, unpack your bags, get rooted, make a difference. But when you realize that you've hit your capacity and you become stagnant, then you just move out and take your multiple learning experiences and move to someplace else because you want to be a content expert in whatever field you're in. But if you've hit that at the place where you're working, it's okay to move out. It's not job hopping.
All right, audience, it's now your time to tell us what the result is. For Team Danielle, raise your red card. For Team Zeb, raise your blue card. We will check the Twitterverse. They're in agreement. Wow. We are going to award our initial findings to Zeb Davenport. But how about a nice round of applause for both Daniel DeSawell and Zeb Davenport.
Awesome. Thank you.
All right, our next topic is master's degree required. Should this degree be required, and is it the best preparation for student affairs professionals? Let's meet our guests for this debate. On one side of the debate, he calls home Warwick, Rhode Island. Currently serves as a student affairs and enrollment management administrator at Bridgewater State University. Recently earned his doctorate in educational leadership from Johnson & Wales. Regularly performs in a hip-hop dance troupe with his family. And claims he can beat just about anyone in a game of Madden, even you, Cindy Love. Here he is, Ed Cabellon.
Whoa! Like a ninja.
And on the opposing side, hailing from Rochester, New York, he's currently the director of curriculum training and research at RoomPact, will be awarded his doctorate in higher education from Boston College this May, has a birthday that coincides with Brazil's equivalent to Valentine's Day, and enjoys Shamrock Shakes more than anything else in the world. Here he is, Paul Gordon Brown. Take it away, Tony.
All right, you're all set, Paul?
I'm ready to go.
All right, your 60-second opening statement. You are, by the way, for student affairs, a master's in student affairs is best preparation. 60
That's
seconds
right.
Starts now.
Yeah, the statement that Ed and I are going to talk about is a student affairs master's degree the best preparation for the field? Yep. And I believe, much like the similar debate earlier, that if I'm going to a doctor, I want that doctor to be an expert in medicine. If I'm a student and I'm going on a college campus, I want to know that those educators know what they're doing. And so that's why I think research, scholarship, the things that we talk about at ACPA are important. So I find it really strange that a newly minted doctor, such as Ed Cabellon, would basically say that all the years he spent studying our research and scholarship is essentially useless. Why get a degree in higher education and student affairs, a doctoral degree, if you don't even need one to do the work you have?
All right, Ed, your rebuttal?
Thank you, Tony. Paul, I think you've been taking way too many iPhone photos. Historically, the student affairs profession has had to evolve and shift due to the responses in internal and external forces, the changing student demographic, and of course, the impact of new technology. And for example, professional roles have been added to student affairs because of that. First year programs, disability resources, and leadership programs have decentralized the broad university functions that have led to more oversight and leadership from student affairs administrators. And for example, the oversight has made our profession more of a leadership one. We now lead our campuses in many of these. Yet, the student affairs graduate programs we speak of still use student development theory as its primary underpinning. And so I argue that that does not fully prepare our student affairs professionals for the field in which they're entering. And so therefore, I do not believe that a student affairs master's program is the best preparation for the field.
All right, Paul, I'm gonna actually ask you, I'll make a statement and then a question. All right, so I don't think you are necessarily suggesting that having a master's or a PhD in student affairs or higher ed necessarily equates to competence, so I want your opinion on that. And then my other thing is, what is it about the experience of a master's program, going through that, what do I learn there that I couldn't come to understand through practice, through supervision, by reading books, by going to institutes, workshops, and so on?
Yeah. You know, I talk a lot about digital technology and online technology, and I look at online student affairs master's programs that are coming online in recent years. Those are okay for individuals that may already be working, because I think a student affairs master's degree is the best preparation, so I want them to get that. But I also see some brand new professionals, before they even enter the field, going into those types of programs. And I think that's a disservice to the students and to our profession. I think we are so uniquely tied to practice, that theory to practice approach, that if you don't have those two things at the same time, it's not a great recipe for success. So although you might be able to do that through professional development, there is something about the cohort-based model and some of these traditional methods that we've used in our master's program that I think makes us effective, more effective educators.
Very good. All right, Ed. So I think most student affairs professionals would consider themselves to be educators. So you and I have children, and I won't speak for you, but I wouldn't be particularly comfortable having someone teach my children that didn't have some classroom and education in pedagogy and child development. So what's the difference when you move that up to a higher ed sphere?
Yeah, great question. I feel like because of how different all our jobs are in student affairs, we may not have that touch point with students initially. So while, you know, our folks in the residence halls and while our folks at orientation may have that common, you know, first touch points with students, and yes, a lot of us will have those along the way, I feel like we can prepare our professionals better by giving them more organizational theory pieces or more ways to make meaningful change, leadership, you know, on campus, because if that's who we are now, because that's how we're seen by other people across the institution, why wouldn't we want to, you know, give them those pieces as part of the education? Because theory to practice for student development theory is great because it's important as part of our foundation, yet, you know, I would challenge folks to think about when the last time they used it in their job, like, and on a regular basis, because it was a daily use of our time. And so I would hope that we could expand that thinking to still include it, but to add more things that would help us do our jobs better.
Okay, very good. All right, to our audience question.
From the audience, we're gonna direct it to Paul. There are fewer student affairs professionals at Canadian institutions with master's degrees in student affairs than in the US. Do you believe this factor has any impact on a gap in Canadian versus U.S. student post-college preparedness?
Oh, this is a trap, isn't it?
It's a trap.
Go ahead.
All right.
It's a trap.
First of all, I will say that I hail from Western Illinois University. That is where I did my master's. And out of the 25 people in my cohort, 5 of them were from Canada. And I think there's a reason for that. I think there is a hunger on the north side of the border for some of the traditional scholarship that's come in student affairs in the United States. But I also think you have to take culture and context into consideration. The higher education system in Canada is not necessarily the same one as in the United States. But while I think that is the fact, I have no doubt that some of our Canadian colleagues, and in speaking with them, have a lot of value in what we've brought here to Canada and have participated in the proceedings here. So I think there's ways to have exchanges, and I think Canada can figure out what best way to credential or help educate their professionals themselves.
Ed, your rebuttal?
I believe that we are now an international field, and that, you know, the opportunities for us to learn from one another and seeing, you know, I've thought about how much I've learned from the folks in this room already from this conference, and there is that need to continue to explore how we can help one another. And that hunger for understanding the American way, while important, I think has to be reciprocal. I think we can learn a lot as well from the world, you know, higher education organizations as well. So I don't think it's an either or, I think it's a both and. And while that's difficult, there's no way it's gonna be easy, intentionality behind that effort is gonna be part of our hallmark moving forward.
All right, we are to our closing statements. You've got 30 seconds to make your closing argument, Paul.
Okay, US presidential election. We have some candidates that don't have the experience or knowledge in the positions for which they seek. To me, that's a problem. To Ed, it doesn't apparently need to be, because you don't need to have a degree or expertise in the position that you're seeking. And I think it matters. I think the scholarship that we do is important. I think we need to learn about it. I think we need to teach it. That's why I think a student affairs master's degree is the best preparation for the field.
All right.
So I want everyone in this room to think back to their grad prep programs, regardless if it was in student affairs or beyond. And I want you to think about your first 3 to 5 years in the profession. And how prepared were you for those first 3 to 5 years? I would argue that there were some organization and leadership pieces, financial and other things that you could have used as part of the program. Our students, our profession is worth a reexamination of our student affairs master's programs, and I ask you for your vote today. Thank you.
This debate was huge.
It was
all right. Raise your cards if you think Paul Gordon Brown is our champion. Raise your red card if you think it's blue. If you think it's Paul, Ed, raise your blue card. We're also going to take into the Twitterverse. And Twitter is going to take us over the hump. We're going to award it to Paul Gordon Brown.
Wow. Congratulations.
Give a big round of applause for both Paul Gordon Brown and Ed Cabellon.
Good job, Ed. Thank you.
All right, our next topic is bright or troubled future. Is the future of our field at risk? Let's meet our guest for this debate. Never gets old. On the optimistic side of the debate, a Connecticut Yankee currently residing in Michigan. She is currently a professor of higher ed and associate dean for undergraduate studies at Michigan State University and a proud alumna of Mount Holyoke College. When not enthusiastically practicing on her fiddle, she enjoys basking in the glory of being a recent newlywed as of January with Melissa, her partner of 19 years. Welcome, Chris Wren. And on the more, shall we say, realistic side of the debate, originally from Apopka, Florida, he is the recently retired assistant vice president and dean of students at the University of Oregon, earned his PhD from Florida State University, is a huge fan of Southern cuisine after being raised in the rural U.S. South, and boasts that he makes the best cheesecake at ACPA. Please welcome Paul Shong.
It's a good sign when they're already hugging, I think.
Heather, take it away.
All right, so Paul, it's Chris actually first. Chris, opening statement.
Great. The future of student affairs is bright. It's easy to fall into the belief, however, that it is at risk. I contend that if we can act smartly, we can use this moment of transformation in higher education to leverage our historic commitments of our field for the benefit of higher education and society. In student affairs, we have an unprecedented opportunity to assist our institutions and external stakeholders at a time when student success is the priority. Certainly, we have a role to play in success as defined in neoliberal terms, such as graduation rates and post-college earnings, metrics to which we have been contributing, by the way, since our formation. But we must also make clear our contributions to success defined as student learning and development, the traditional location of our work. By involving ourselves as full partners in the work of student success, we reassert that educating students is a central purpose of universities. And to be sure, universities that continue to bundle research and knowledge production with teaching and robust student life opportunities face pressures to act more and more like corporations. But we have the opportunity and indeed the obligation to assert student success as a critical ongoing priority in which we play an irreplaceable role.
Excellent, excellent. Paul, the more realistic perspective, perhaps. 60 seconds begins now.
First, let me say that I have the utmost respect for Chris Wren, and although this debate is going to be huge, I know that her hands and mine are approximately the same size.
I can leave out, right?
you go. Time, right? According to Bloomberg, college tuition and fees have increased 1,120% since records began in 1978. This astounding increase far exceeds the inflationary increases of consumer goods, medical expenses, and food. For colleges and universities, competition increases for students who can afford to attend, and faculty and staff are required to be more entrepreneurial, pursuing extramural funding, distracting them from their teaching, mentoring, and service responsibilities. Newly adopted business and commercially oriented approaches, such as reputation management, brand management, enrollment management, and even risk management, contends and distracts us from the student affairs credo of promoting the growth of the whole student and carefully nurturing the development of individuals as opposed to customers.
All right. Okay, Chris, my question for you is, how can you look on the bright side when institutions are facing major budget cuts, when student affairs professionals struggle with articulating their value, and when we are seen as the poster children for administrative bloat?
Well, certainly at an institution like the one from which Paul has just retired, which was more or less owned by Nike for the last 10 years, those things might be true. But when we look across the range of institutions, from community colleges, liberal arts colleges, and public research universities, and others, we certainly see that there are a number of opportunities where, yes, we can get better at doing what we do, but certainly joining with our partners on academic success missions, reasserting that we know how to teach students, not just how to teach chemistry, for example. I think that student affairs has a role to play in convincing people that it's not about administrative bloat, as it were, although some administrators are bloated, not Paul, but thinking about the ways that we can be parsimonious in our use of resources while getting the maximum impact for what we do spend. I think pointing out that the what appears to be a decline in graduation rates over time would actually have been worse without student affairs than it is with student affairs is another way we can reassert our value to the institution.
All right. Paul, my question for you is, the National Association of College Employers data suggests that the learning and development that happens outside the classroom is as, if not more, important than that happens inside. Isn't this a cause for hope?
It is a cause for hope, but I want to emphasize that we want to make sure that that continues, and we want to make sure that people who are very specialized these days in our various branches of student affairs and enrollment management and risk management and so forth continue to focus on growing and contributing to the development of the whole student. I think that is the part of this that really bothers me the most and causes me the greatest concern, is that as we become more and more specialized and as we become more involved in the management, that we forget about the development of students and the very important role that that plays, both inside as well as outside the classroom. Also, I want to mention that Chris has pointed out some issues that have to do with big-time college athletics. However, I want to say, as a proud alumni of Florida State University and formerly as a member of the professional staff at the University of Oregon, Chris doesn't have a whole lot of room to talk at Michigan State University.
We won this year, just to point that out.
Go green.
Go white.
Yeah.
All right, from the Twitterverse and from our audience participation, gonna throw this one to Chris. Isn't the rise of online and for-profit institutions with many students successfully completing degrees with little or no contact with a student affairs staff member indication that we aren't as necessary as we used to be? 45 seconds.
Whoever contributed that question, I appreciate your attempt, but that is actually wrong. We have not seen increasing numbers of graduates. Online institutions and for-profit institutions have incredibly much higher lack of completion rates. They're relying increasingly on federal funding, and it is much more likely for a student who starts there to leave without a degree and incredibly much student debt, much more than a publicly supported institution, which is why the public needs to continue to support higher education.
Paul, you have 45 seconds for a rebuttal.
Well, I like Chris's answer, and I liked her question, but I also want to emphasize that those students that are on online programs do receive some support from student affairs professionals. And the issue that I want to raise and continue to push is I want to make sure that those student affairs professionals, as they're doing that very specialized work in an altogether different environment than many of us are accustomed to at our own colleges and universities, have access to the broader thinking and the bigger approaches with regard to the development of the whole student, and that we think not only in terms of developing or promoting very special kinds of services and presenting them, but also at the same time nurture broader growth and development.
All right, now we are ready for our closing statements. Chris, you have 30 seconds.
I argue that the current neoliberal refrain about higher education has inadvertently handed the student affairs profession a golden opportunity to assert our centrality to the mission and future of higher education. By reframing how we contribute to student success, not just in graduation rates, but also in learning and development, we have a chance to breathe new life into our practices and our rhetoric. There has never been a more important time to do so. And when we do, we will see a bright future for higher education and our place in it.
Awesome. All right, closing statement for you, Paul. 30 seconds.
I want to encourage us all to think, as we begin to focus on the very specialized kinds of services that we're providing these days and called upon to provide, that we, in the process of doing the different kinds of management things that we do, that we not substitute student development for student management. That in fact, we continue to think big thoughts and we continue to create opportunities for us to think about spirituality, as has Small in her new book. And we all continue to think about beyond tolerance, something that was from a bigger environment.
All right, audience, tough decision here. Red for Team Paul, blue for Team Chris. We'll consult the Twitterverse.
The future's so bright, you're awesome.
We're gonna award it to Chris Wren. Round of applause for both Chris and Paul. Although, we will say that you all weren't supposed to hold up your true colors color as well, okay? Bunch of optimists. Our next topic is faculty versus practitioners. Who is more in touch with our students and the realities of our field as a whole? Let's meet our guests for this debate. On one side of the debate, her students call her Dr. Practice, originally from Pensacola, Florida. She is a proud student, she is currently a proud student affairs administrator at The Ohio State University, earned her first degree in forestry and wildlife from Virginia Tech, and will ride 100 miles by bicycle in the Petalonia 16 this August to raise funds for cancer research. Please welcome Gretchen Metzellers. And on the opposing side, her students call her Dr. Theory. Hailing from Cleveland, Ohio, she's currently on the faculty at The Ohio State University, earned her PhD in college student personnel from the University of Maryland, completed a 3-day bicycle journey following part of the Underground Railroad path in Ohio, and was one of the original ice cream makers at Ben & Jerry's. Please welcome Susan Jones. All right, Tony, take it away.
Okay, Susan, you are in favor or arguing that our practitioners should be better using our research out there. You've got 60 seconds to make your opening argument.
All right, thanks, Tony. So what do student affairs educators need to know to effectively work with students? This is a question posed by Marcia Baxter Magolda and Peter Magolda in a recent book chapter. Well, one thing good student affairs educators need to know is the research that informs the field. Now, practitioners tend to give research a bad rap, as I'm sure you'll hear from my debate partner in a second. But what drives research is intellectual curiosity, and most researchers in student affairs develop their empirical studies from being curious about issues and problems grounded in the realities of practice. They don't make these things up in the ivory tower and their lives in the clouds. So practitioners may argue that they don't have time to read research, that many studies are out of touch with what the problems they're confronting on a daily basis. But if practice is not informed by research, what is it guided by? Their personal experiences? Sure, practitioners know a lot from experience, and experience can be a good guide, but it also can be limiting, and sometimes it's wrong. So would you seek advice from a lawyer or a medical doctor whose practice was not informed by the latest legal and scientific research in the field?
Very good, all right. Gretchen, your response, 60 seconds.
I find many obstacles in applying research to practice. With research-controlled experiments, our conversations allow researchers to isolate an aspect of a student's behavior or allow the effect of an intervention. This may be useful for researchers, but it's not very helpful for practitioners. We're left trying to figure out how to implement their findings in complex campus environments with a multiplicity of students. And why does it take so long to get enlightenment from researchers to the practitioner? When I needed informed research to provide to our Board of Trustees concerning student mental health, the research that was available was either 20 years old or in the pipeline. And in the pipeline meant it'd be available to me in 8 to 10 months, and that's just not helpful. My last rant is about relevance. As much as I appreciate my colleague's work, I could have suggested more relevant ways for her to inform her favorite practitioner rather than researching college students' perceptions of their required high school service learning experiences. I'm just saying.
All right, so you ready? Here's my question for you, Susan. So do you really believe that all research is deserving of our attention? With what seems like an avalanche of research over the last few decades, how are practitioners like myself supposed to differentiate the relevance and cutting edge from the redundant and inconsequential?
Well, apparently my practitioner partner over there, it doesn't see this avalanche. It hasn't hit her yet. but let me also respond to Gretchen's slam of my research on required community service, because this is actually a great illustration of my point. There's a big rush by many practitioners to require service because they assume it's all good all the time, when in fact the research shows that required service produces opposite of these intended outcomes. So I would expect, Tony, to answer your question, and given what we've heard from some of our prior debaters, that good practitioners are able to discern good research from not so good research and can navigate selection of studies that will actually help them make sense of what they're confronting on a daily basis. And not all research is excellent research, but we need to be, as good professionals, good consumers of research.
All right. Gretchen, so to Susan's point, if we didn't use data and research to help inform our decisions, wouldn't that call into question our intentionality, our legitimacy within academia? So if we did base it, as you suggest, on personal experiences, on gut intuition, on our own knowledge, would we be taken seriously in academia?
I don't think we would be taken seriously, but the plethora of research that's rolling down the pipeline that comes from our student affairs colleagues needs to be condensed for us and given to us in a more digestible way than comes to us now. I get most of my knowledge and from our grad students right now, because what they bring to us is what's most relevant and what's most current, and I appreciate that from them. What we are doing as senior level administrators is putting out major fires, literal and figuratively, in the institution. So I appreciate the knowledge that our younger professionals bring to us. It's hard within the academy to find what's relevant and timely. So I appreciate the research that's done, but being able to sift through it is incredibly difficult.
Very good. All right. Back to you, Matt.
Audience question to Susan. Many campuses are reintroducing or adding additional faculty in residence options. Would you support schools adding a mandatory in residence requirement for higher ed faculty as a requirement for tenure? Why or why not?
Ooh.
I think that is an excellent option for some faculty. I know that I've had conversations with my student affairs colleagues when I get invited as an example of a student affairs faculty partnership to come judge an ice cream building Sunday contest at midnight during exam week, and I have to explain that usually during exam week I'm grading exams. So the demands on us are different, and I think we need to appreciate each other's demands, not assign blame as to who's working harder than the other, or assume that we all need to be doing the same work. I think we're at our best when we understand that faculty culture and student affairs culture share some similarities, but are also very different.
45-second rebuttal to Gretchen.
I don't know that it's even conceptualized, possibly. With 15,000 students on campus, I don't know how we could be effective with faculty and residents, though I'd love to give it a shot. We have 3,000 students in one building, so how you be effective with a faculty member in residence is difficult. But we have faculty working with students, and it makes a wonderful and remarkable change in students when they actually are able to talk one-on-one with the faculty. So having that opportunity, I would love to give it a shot.
All right, the model at Ohio State University.
Here we go.
All right, so we are to our final closing arguments. We've got 30 seconds to finish up.
All right, so what does it mean to be a professional? It means that our practice is guided by something beyond our own experiences. It means that our practice should be informed by the scholarship in our field. We're advancing a false dichotomy and suggesting that all faculty are out of touch and all practitioners can't see beyond their day-to-day. What we really need is to invigorate a dialogue across this false divide of research and practice. Thinking and doing with research opens up possibilities for effective practice rather than simplifying it. Students and their experiences are too complex, and we owe it more to students than capturing their lives in a soundbite.
Very good.
Research can be helpful to practitioners if it's timely, relevant, and applicable. I need help with the issues that weigh on me daily. Help me understand the student who becomes a binge drinker by their second semester. Help me understand parents who show up for advising meetings. Help me understand how students who come with everything cannot succeed, while students who come with nothing are incredibly successful. Help me understand.
All right, audience. It's now time to choose our winner. If you are Team Gretchen, raise your red card. If you are Team Susan, raise your blue card. Grad students, your faculty members are watching which card you raise.
Let's see what Twitter says.
We'll also take our Twitter vote. And we are going to call it with the Twitter for red. Team Gretchen.
You were outnumbered at the conference. That's
very
fun.
Close. Very close. Give both Gretchen and Susan a big round of applause.
Good score.
I have more to say.
See her after.
Our next topic is coddling our intrusive practices, helping or hurting students in the long run. Let's meet our guests for this debate. On one side of the debate, he calls Minneapolis, Minnesota home, works as a speaker, consultant, and coach, and earned his PhD from the University of Maryland. While not preparing for this debate, he spends each day trying to be a great father, learning from his children's brilliance. A few of his claims to fame are that one of his summer roommates went on to become a U.S. Senate candidate, and once he slept on the floor of Prince's house. Here he is, Keith Edwards. And hailing from the birthplace of America, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, she serves as a university, a proud alum of Norfolk State University, and she is a self-proclaimed connoisseur of buffalo wings. Her first word as a baby was Nershey, as in Hershey chocolate, and prefers to go by the moniker Dr. Stacy. Welcome, Stacy Pearson Wharton. All right, Heather, take it away.
All right, so Stacy, you are arguing that coddling is good. You have 60 seconds to proceed.
So what the heck is coddling anyway? Are we talking about caring for people, doing our jobs, doing right by students? I'd say absolutely. But as opposed to using the word coddling, I like the word scaffolding. That is helping students to move from one place to another in a way that developmentally works for them. And so we would not provide the same services for freshmen or first-year students that we would provide for seniors, but we would move from a more developmental model. How many people out there, if you had a choice between the Waldorf Astoria versus Motel 6 or a Kipton versus Holiday Inn, most of us, by raise of hands, you would choose the Kipton, yes? Well, students feel the exact same way, that our admissions office sells them a product, and part of that is that we will care and take care of them and help them grow developmentally. It also helps our graduation rate and, importantly, alumni giving.
All right, very interesting. Keith, your question, you were ready for your opening statement, 60 yeah. seconds? Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Stacy. I agree with all of that, actually. Many of our students do need more care and support than others. And I think coddling is harmful. We have to be careful that in our desire to support students, we're not getting in the way of their learning and growth. The foundation of education is to provide high expectations and a lot of support to help students reach that. If we treat college students like children, we'll graduate children, and that's a failure of our responsibility. Students need obstacles to learn. If the obstacles are too big, they get overwhelmed and learning doesn't happen. If the obstacles are small or not there, then they don't have to learn new ways of doing, being, or knowing to navigate those obstacles. Our job is to provide obstacles that are just right, support that is just right too. Our over-support may seem caring and justice-oriented, but it can prevent students from gaining the skills and understanding of how to navigate this imperfect world.
All right, my first question is for you, Stacy. The days of in loco parentis are over.
Are they?
They are over.
Mm.
And I looked up synonyms of coddling, and I found pampering, babying, indulging, spoiling. How can this be helpful if we want to create self-actualized adults that are capable of leading the next generation and solving the world's problems?
Well, I actually looked up the synonyms for coddling as well. And what I found was overwhelming kindness. It is that not why we got into this work with students. And as a result of that, all of the research bears out that things like intrusive practices increases graduation rates. And some of us live in states that if your students don't graduate within a 6-year time period, that your funding is cut by the state. What's also true is that our campuses, the stability financially is connected to alumni giving. And so I love my Norfolk State because of how I was treated while I was there, the way that I was cared for, and even challenged in the process of being cared for and that overwhelming kindness. And that's why I think that we should do more scaffolding, not coddling, okay. of students.
All right.
Can I say one more thing? If the counseling center director does not support coddling, who will?
That is true. Counseling director. All right, Keith, I can't help but think of Goldilocks. Uh-huh. This one's too big, this one's too small, this one's just right. How do you propose, in an ever-changing world with an increasingly complex student body, that we are going to mass customization and really give students the level of support that they need that's just right?
Well, that's exactly right. And I think that's the challenge, that these intrusive practices, if we don't provide students with enough support, then that's not going to work, and they're not going to graduate, and they're not going to learn. On the other hand, if we provide them with way too much support, they may graduate, they may take enough credits, but then we leave them out into the world not knowing how to do their laundry, not knowing how to interact with people who are different from them, not knowing how to navigate the world in all its imperfections, and expecting that when things don't go my way, someone's going to help me out. And there are college campuses where that can be done. There are certainly campuses where the scale of that gets harder. But I think my concern is if we provide too much support, that may make us look good. It may make the institution look good. But it can actually be a disservice to our students. And that's why we have student affairs professionals to do that on the micro level individually and on the macro level, looking at data, looking at trends, looking at our population, looking at our assessment, looking at all of those things, so we can do the best we can to get the porridge just right.
All right, audience question to Stacy. Employers are telling us that our students are not independent, don't feel comfortable even making simple phone calls, and are ill-prepared for interviews. If that's not evidence of the detriments of coddling, what do you attribute those behaviors to?
Well, I think that we can't throw the baby out with the bathwater. What's true is that students come to our campuses having been maybe overly pampered, or millennials come really being taken care of well. Mm-hmm. And so that is why I advance the concept of scaffolding more than coddling, if you will, because it's about helping to wean them off of needing that support so that they can be prepared. But even in that, overwhelming kindness can still be a part of their experience of our universities. I also think that as well is that students are coming to campus with more severe pathology as far as it relates to mental health concerns, whether that be the spectrum disorder or other things, and being able to really help them walk that out and graduate with a degree is important.
Keith, 45-second rebuttal.
Well, I think Stacey makes a great point that we are seeing more students who need ever greater rates of assistance and support, and we absolutely have to provide that. But just because a student comes expecting us to take care of everything and bail them out and wants that and demands that and get parents to call for that are oftentimes very entitled students and the students who need the least amount of support but demand it. Mm-hmm. And I think as we're being constantly doing asked to do more with less, we have to direct those resources to those who most need it, as Stacey mentioned, and make sure that we're not tending to people who want it and demand it, who maybe don't need it, because that creates this aggrieved entitlement, and we don't want to send those people out in the world to be employees or parents or my next door neighbor.
All right, audience, it's time to pick
closing statements.
Oh, my gosh,
statements.
I'm sorry.
That's okay.
I got carried away.
I know.
I guess you did.
It is our final round, so closing statements. We have 30 seconds. Stacey.
So at our orientation at my university, we had a button that says, here to help. And coddling, overwhelming kindness is exactly that mentality of here to help. We know that students of color oftentimes need extra support, or other students as well. Mm-hmm. And it's not an all or nothing or a binary in a way that it really is about the balance. I encourage you, when you are picking a college for your student or somebody in your life, choose the Waldorf.
Okay. Keith, your closing statement, 30 seconds.
We don't always have that option. I agree with much of what Stacey said, but I find the reason that sometimes we're intrusive is not for the students or even for the institution. But sometimes it's to meet our own needs, our unmet emotional needs and fears. It can be so tempting to try and solve students' problems for them because then they tell us how great we are. But that's not our job. Our job is to help them learn how to solve their own problems. We might not get the credit for that, but that's our job. We certainly don't need to be in search of student crises to justify our own professional roles and our personal worthiness. We need to make sure we get those needs met elsewhere. Go Terps, go Rams, oh Canada.
Okay, now it is time to vote. For Team Keith, raise your red card. For Team Stacey, raise your blue card. Wow. We'll check in with the interwebs.
But it looks like
we're gonna give it to Keith. How about a big congratulations, Keith, and a big round of applause for Keith and Stacey.
Great job.
How about a big round of applause for all of our debaters today? While these debates may be over, the conversation should continue. All of our participants encourage you to partake in regular, healthy discourse. The future and strength of our field depends on it. Thank you so much for joining us at this very special edition of Student Affairs Live from ACPA in beautiful Montreal, Canada. Let's hear it for our moderators and your hosts, Heather Shea Gasser and Tony Duty. To watch or share this or any other episode, tune into higheredlive.com. Join Tony next week for an episode on ending sexual violence, and join Heather on March 30th on an episode, the authors of the third edition of the Student Development Theory Handbook with Chris Wren. That is all the time we have for today, folks. For those of you tuning in online, enjoy your Tuesday, and for those of you here in Montreal, get out there and enjoy some poutine. For Student Affairs Live, I'm Matt Ferguson. Thanks for stopping by. Yeah.